I want to welcome each one of you, my brothers and sisters, for the lesson study, the Bible study on Revelation chapter 15 and 16. This is the 11th Sabbath school lesson with the title, The Seven Last Plagues. Today it's in English. May the peace and the blessing of Jesus be with each one of us as we study Revelation chapter 15 and 16. Before we proceed, we want to pause for a word of prayer. Loving Father, we want to thank you so much at this time. Thank you for the privilege to study your word, especially Revelation chapter 15 and 16. Lord, help each one of us to understand the deeper truths which are hidden in these two chapters. Lord, especially open our minds, Lord, with our human understanding. It is impossible for us to grasp these important truths, but only with the help of your Holy Spirit, Lord, we will be able to understand and also apply them to our lives. Bless us, bless the people who are watching, and also bless those who are sharing with others these wonderful truths. Bless also those people who are sharing online with other friends. Bless us, Lord, because we pray in Jesus' loving name. Amen. My brothers and sisters, today a very, very important lesson also, like other lessons. Now, it is Revelation chapter 15 and 16. I know we are studying and learning many wonderful truths pertaining to the last days in the light of a now historicist interpretation. Today we are going to study the seven last plagues. The moment you hear the word in English, plague, I know that is something which brings destruction. And in the time of John, and even in the time of the Bible translators, King James Version, the word plague had no way to escape death in those days, because there was no remedy, there was no treatment, there was no medicine available to escape death. That's why plague now is the sure, inescapable death to the people. But in this context, the seven last plagues, it is said, which means the last event on this earth before second coming. The last major event on this earth before second coming. That's why it is entitled as Seven Last Plagues. Now, often the question is asked, are the plagues real or is it symbolic? Like many other symbolic expressions in Book of Revelation, like seven stars, seven golden lampstands, you see, or white horse, red horse, black horse, pale horse. Is it something symbolic? The answer is no. Because these are real. And you may say, how do you know that? Surely from the study of the Bible. And all of us can remember, in the days of Moses and Israelites, God brought 10 plagues in Egypt before he delivered them from Egypt to Canaan. Now, so were those 10 plagues, were they real? Answer is yes. Definitely, those plagues really happened. The water of the Nile River, really became blood. And the frogs really came. So, and the last plague, the firstborn died. The firstborn in every house, including Pharaoh's house, died. Except those people who applied the blood of the lamb, which God told to offer on their doorposts, they were saved. Surely, those who are washed in the blood of Jesus, those who accept Jesus as the personal Savior, only they can escape these plagues. Nobody can. So that's why the plagues are going to be real, because the 10 plagues in Egypt were real. We can read about them in Exodus chapter 7 to 12. Exodus chapters 7th chapter up to 12th chapter, we can read all the 10 plagues which God brought. Now, likewise, before He takes God's people to now heavenly Canaan, this is heaven, God is going to again bring 7 plagues, the last event. That's the 7 last plagues. Then with that, God will deliver His people, and also God will punish those wicked people. That's what happened to people in Egypt. Pharaoh and his ministers and advisors and all of those who turned their back on God and the truth, surely they suffered. This is what is going to happen. So this is going to be real. Then another question comes up in the minds of many people. And often they ask me, "Oh, Professor Sharath Babu, how long these 7 last plagues will last?" Which means, how much will be the duration? If there is any information, any piece of information on that. Many students ask me in the classroom in our Spicer Adventist University. Or many times people ask me whenever I go for conducting some revival meetings. Sure, there is an answer in the Bible. Revelation chapter 18 verse 8. Revelation chapter 18 verse 8 says, all the plagues came in one day. And we know, we learned already in the Bible prophecy, especially book of Daniel and book of Revelation, when God says one day prophetically, prophetic time, then that is equal to one full human year. For our human time, it is 1 year. So all the plagues came in one day. Revelation chapter 18 verse 8, which means in our human time, it is one full year. Which means we need to understand, once the 7 last plagues, that means the first plagues, comes on this earth, then we should know within this year, within that year, whenever the first plague begins, we should understand within that year, Jesus' second coming will take place. Because right after 7 last plagues, Jesus is going to come back second time, take all of His people to heaven. That's why it's a 1 year time. And also it is said in Revelation 18 verse 10, all the plagues came in 1 hour, which means, I explain this way, the maximum time, once the first plague starts, the maximum time is 1 year. Minimum time, or the severe, now gravity of the plagues, or now severity, the severe pain of or suffering of all the plagues will be 1 hour, means 15 human days. That is minimum. So that's why this is the duration. Then many people ask also the question and say, when do you think the plagues would begin? Some people ask and say, now, are there any plagues anywhere in the world? Are the plagues already there on the world, or started in the world somewhere in some part of the world? Answer is no. Plagues did not start yet. Plagues did not start. But they're going to start. They're going to be poured out. When? We are told in Revelation chapter 15 verse 8. Revelation chapter 15 verse 8. It says, the temple was filled with the smoke, and nobody could enter the temple till the 7 last plagues are over. Which means now our high priest, our mediator, Jesus, is in the heavenly sanctuary pleading for us. But now He leaves the sanctuary. When does Jesus leave the sanctuary? When Jesus leaves the heavenly sanctuary as our mediator, as our intercessor, as our high priest, we call that technically close of probation. Close of probation. So 7 last plagues are going to be poured out by God on this earth right after close of probation. Now, just before the close of probation. And we have an event where we are told in Great Controversy book page 624 to 627, Satan would come in the form of Christ and land in the cities and towns to deceive the people. This is the last greatest deception. Satan would come and land from the sky, landing on the earth, imitating like Jesus Christ's second coming. And people who are not fully knowing the details of book of Revelation and book of Daniel, they would go and fall at his feet and say, Christ has come, Christ has come. We have waited for him so long. I know. Jesus also gave us a warning in Matthew chapter 24, verse 24, saying, now, in the last days, false Christ will come. False Christ will come. And false prophets. They will do miracles to deceive the very elect. Surely, Paul also gives us a warning in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 14, which says, don't be marvel or don't be surprised at this. Satan will come like an angel of light. Surely this is the greatest deception, the last deception. Then, after which probation closes. Right after close of probation, then we can see first plague now being poured out. That's why we read in Revelation chapter 15, which is an introduction to seven last plagues. And in fact, the key text or the memory text is in Revelation chapter 15, verse 4. Oh God, you are holy, you are righteous, and who will not worship you? Your judgments are on. Surely the days will come after the second coming. Now, there won't be anyone who will not worship. In the whole universe, everybody will worship. Why? Not because they're forced, not because they want some benefit. Because he's holy, he's righteous, he's gracious, he's loving, and he's the creator, and also he's sustainer, he's the redeemer. That's why they choose to worship, not forced by anyone. So, now the seven last plagues. Symbolically, now John saw seven angels standing with the seven, now containers, if you want to compare that way. Now some Bibles translate this one as bowl. Now, seven containers or seven bowls with the, now symbolically, full of God's wrath, God's anger. Now, who's going to receive? This is what again is the question many people ask me and say, who will receive the plagues? Who will suffer the plagues? And surely, again with the example of plagues in Egypt, 10 plagues, who suffered those plagues? Not Israelites, not God's people. The firstborn dead in the 10th plague, in every family, including the family of Pharaoh. But nothing happened to Israelites. Nobody died that day. Not even a lamb, not even a dog, not even a goat that day. Nothing died. Why? God protected. Because they obeyed God, they applied the blood of the lamb on their doorpost. Likewise, those who trust in Jesus, those who accepted Jesus as their personal savior, they will not suffer these seven last plagues. Then who will suffer? Those who rejected the God of the universe, those who rejected the God of the Bible, those who refused to walk in the light of God's word and the Ten Commandments. They will suffer. They will suffer. In fact, we are told, Revelation chapter 16, verse 2. Revelation chapter 16, verse 2. And those who worship the beast and his image, they will receive and they will suffer the seven last plagues. So that's why, as God's people, if you have accepted Jesus as your personal savior, and if you are walking in the light of God's word, the Bible, and the commandments, and have taken baptism in immersion water, or which we call in the water, that is by immersion, that means dipping somebody under the water. Because I want to emphasize that when there are many people and some churches, who are not giving baptism in the water, they sprinkle or they make people to walk under a flag, and they are doing different ways. Bible only tells about the baptism by immersion. Those who were baptized for the remission of their sin or for the forgiveness of their sin, surely they will not suffer, they will not be affected by seven last plagues, as God's people in Egypt did not suffer. That's why that's a good news for all the believers. That's why definitely the seven last plagues is a message of love of Jesus. In his love, he has given this message so that we and our families should not suffer, should not go through the seven last plagues. Jesus in his love has revealed this one 2000 years ago almost to John the Revelator. That's why this message is there in the book of Revelation. Often we think seven last plagues, the message in seven last plagues, which is recorded in Revelation chapter 16, is a very frightening, terrifying message, we think. No, God doesn't want any one of us to perish and suffer these plagues. That's why he has revealed, so that we will make every necessary preparation to accept Jesus as the personal Savior. So the plagues will fall on those who worship the beast. Who is the beast? We have identified in Revelation 12 and 13 chapters. The beast represents a political kingdom. But in this context, the beast is the papal power, the papacy. And the image to the beast is they're going to enforce now a day of worship, which is contrary to the Bible day of worship. In the Bible, God said, he created everything in 6 days, rested on the seventh day, and he blessed the day, and he sanctified the day, he made it holy. This is in Genesis chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. The fourth commandment, it is repeated in Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 to 11, saying, I have created everything in 6 days and rested on the seventh day. That's why you and your family or your animals, your servants, nobody should do any work, but only worship God. In fact, last week we studied also, the first angel was saying, worship him that created heavens and the earth and the fountains of the water. Who created this whole world and the other parts of the universe, other worlds also? This is Jesus. This is Jesus. We are told about that when in Hebrews chapter 1 verse 2, the last part says, and through his son, he created the worlds. Yes, Jesus is the creator. That's why Revelation chapter 14 verse 7, the last part, first angel says, worship him who created the heavens and the earth and the sea and the fountains of the water. We need to worship. But unfortunately today, the world has forgotten the day of worship, the fourth commandment. They have neglected and almost buried it. And they worship Sunday as the day of worship. And is there anywhere in the Bible which Jesus or his disciples are saying that Jesus died and resurrected on Sunday, so we have to worship? We don't have anywhere in the Bible. If you don't have anywhere in the Bible. But in fact, Jesus worshipped on Sabbath while he was on this earth. Luke chapter 4 verse 16. All the disciples and Paul also worshipped on Sabbath, which God gave at the beginning of this world. That's why surely now his image, those who worship the beast and his image, Revelation 16 2, is now that day will be forced on us, forced worship, as happened to Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego in Babylon. They were forced to worship that golden image. Likewise, in the last days, we will be forced to worship the day which they are going to set up, that is the Sunday. Because that is what conveniently the whole world has adopted. Even non-Christian countries, even some countries which are not Christian countries, some Muslim countries, Buddhist countries and Hindu countries also adopted Sunday as a day of weekly rest. If you ask them why, they don't have a reason. Because the whole world is doing, they do it. That's why surely it will be enforced on us. But those who are now worshipping under the pressure of the government decrees. What happened to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? The king of the whole world at that time, Nebuchadnezzar, said, "Who is that God who will save you from my hand if you don't worship? I will cast you into the fiery furnace." Surely he cast them into the fiery furnace. That is death decree. That also is going to come. If you don't worship and obey, then we will be now put to death. This is what we are told in Revelation chapter 13 verse 15. We studied also a couple of weeks ago. But now, those who worship because of the fear, because they cannot buy or sell. We studied that one 2 weeks ago, Revelation chapter 13 verse 16 to 18, about the 666. Sure, by doing that, they receive the mark of the beast. This is what we call worshipping the beast and his image, which means the day which is not in the Bible, which they'll force people to do. If they do it under the pressure, because they're forced, they will receive the mark of the beast. Those who receive the mark of the beast will receive or will suffer all the seven plagues. What are those seven plagues? Really, they're going to come. Not yet come, they're going to come, or they're going to be poured out. Symbolically, the angel, the first angel, with his container or with his bowl, and then he poured out God's anger on this earth. Then what happened? A very painful sore, painful sores. And now they were inflicted with painful sores from head to foot. Very painful. Can't even explain or describe them in human words. That much pain from head to foot. They can't sit, they can't walk, they can't lie down. Terrible pain. This is called sores or boils on the body. I know sometimes if you get one sore or one boil on the body because of some now heat during the summer, I know people suffer, they have so much pain and fever, they are just on the bed. But if they're suffering, if they have from head to foot, all the whole body, the sores, the painful boil, I tell you, this is going to be terrible. But definitely, at that time, they cannot get any help, because we are told in Revelation chapter 16 verse 1, all of these plagues are poured out now from the temple of God. That means God is now sending these plagues. God has given the power to angels to pour out this is anger. That's why it is God's work, God's act, God's act. Why? Why God is so angry? Why God is punishing people? Surely, the wicked people, they punished God's people in the last. They're going to punish God's people. They are restricted. They cannot buy or cannot sell. So, that's why, since God's people suffered from these wicked people, God is going to punish them with these sores. Then sometimes they ask me the question and say, at that time when they get that painful boil on their body, can they go to the nearest now hospital or some medical doctor to get some painkiller injection or painkiller medicine? Can they do that one? No, they cannot. Why? At that time, all the people who rejected God's truth and not followed the Ten Commandments, they will suffer. Whatever the profession, medical doctor or a nurse or a chemist, whatever, everybody will suffer. But you may say, why can't those people come to God's people, the Christian, true Christians, who are medical doctors and nurses? They can, but we are told by Jesus that when the time of trouble comes, God's people should flee to the mountains. That is in Matthew chapter 24 verse 16. Jesus said, flee to the mountains. You stay there in the mountain. But some of you may say, oh, that's nice. Some of you may be having a house in your house on some mountain somewhere, wherever you live. I know I went for ministry in northeast part of India, close to Burma border, Myanmar border. Or last year I had the privilege to visit and preach in Kenya, in a place called Kisi, the state of Kisi, all mountainous area. So their houses are on the mountains. Then can they say, oh, we are lucky, we are here, because Jesus said, go to the mountains. No, that not those mountains which are already inhabited. I know many parts of the world, many people, they live in the mountains. They build houses, they live their whole life in the mountains. But where Jesus said is, go to mountains which are not inhabited. We have to go there. We have to be there. That's why if God's people now are there in those mountains or in the forests, then those medical doctors, those nurses who are believers will not be able to render any services, medical services. The other people, all the others, they're all flat. They're not able to go anyway. And all the, let us say, so-called drug stores, in India we call medical store or medical shop, everything will be closed. No transportation during this time. Because who can drive any vehicle? You call it car, or whether you call it train, whether you call it aeroplane, no mode of transportation for anyone. Because everybody is down because of the first plague, painful sores from head to foot. So now, this is what is going to happen. Then you may say, ask the question and say, when God's people obey God's word and go to the mountains, flee to the mountains or the forest, then what about their food and water? Sure, God gave us a promise. Isaiah 33 verse 16. Isaiah 33 verse 16, it says, the mountains will be his refuge. That means mountains will be our protection, like a fort. Then food will be supplied, water will be supplied. This is what God promised. We know the experience of Israelites. 40 years, he fed them every day with manna, angel's food. Manna rained from the heaven, except on the Sabbath day. Then when they had no water to drink, and God told Moses to hit the rock with the stick which was in his hand, the water gushed out. You can read that in Numbers chapter 20. Surely, God will take care of our food and water, and God will provide protection for us in those mountains. But we need to obey. So when that time of trouble comes, or when you notice the first plague is falling, that is the time for us to flee. Or when you hear Satan is now landing somewhere, appearing, just like Christ, but everybody cannot see him at the same time. He will do it in one town or one city at a time, because he cannot duplicate that which Jesus is going to do. But when real Jesus comes, real Jesus will come after seven plagues. But this false Christ or the deceiver will come before seven last plagues. We need to understand that also. The deceiver will come, Satan will come before seven last plagues to deceive the world. But he will be appearing here and there. So that is the time to flee to the mountain. So first plague is the painful sores on the bodies of the people who rejected the truth of God. The second plague, all the seawater turns to blood. When the angel poured out his anger on this earth in a symbolic form with his container or with that bowl which is in his hand, then all the seawater turns to blood. We need to understand one important aspect, that is, definitely this plague is not universal. That means it's not everywhere on this earth, the second plague. Why? Because there are many parts of the world, the sea is far away from them. See, they don't have the sea. For example, I live here in the city of Pune in India. And we don't have sea anywhere nearby. If we have to go to the sea, at least we have to drive at least 2-3 hours from here. Or, I know a few times I went to preach in northeast part of India, all mountainous region. And if they want to see how the sea looks, what is sea, they have to travel one full night by express train, or at least 1 hour flight from their area to just to see how the sea looks. Far away. So such places, I know. I also said last year I went to Kenya, that state of Kisi. No sea anywhere nearby. If they want to see how the sea looks, they have to go all the way to Mombasa. Likewise, so far place. So that's why wherever there is no sea in that area, this plague will not have any effect. So second plague is not everywhere. Wherever there is sea, surely they will suffer. But I want you to notice one thing. The most crowded cities, very, very important cities of this world are located on the seashore. For example, in India, city called Calcutta and city called Chennai or Madras city, city called Bombay, the commercial capital of India, and cities like Surat and many cities and villages and small towns are located on the seashore, or something like now Tokyo, the capital city of Japan, or Beijing, the capital of China. Many other major cities are located on the seashore. So now, because of the sea turned to blood, all of those cities and all of those coastal towns and villages will be affected. Because it not only became blood, it became like a poisonous blood, blood of a dead person. Which means because of that, we are told in Revelation chapter 16, verse 3, all the sea creatures died. Then what is the law of the sea? If anything dies, in few hours, that will be washed away to the seashore. Then if all the fish and all the tortoise and all the living creatures in the sea die, they'll be washed away to the seashores. Then who can make use of those fish and the tortoise and big, big sharks and big, big whale? I know. If it is normal time, people would eat them now, enjoying them, relishing. But now they're having tough time to go to, so to speak, restroom, the toilet. So they can't do anything. Nobody can gather even and take them to market and sell them in the fish market. Because everybody's suffering down because of the first plague. So what happens? If nobody is picking them, what will happen in few days to all of the dead fish and dead tortoise and all the dead creatures of the sea? They'll be rotting. And if they're rotting, what will happen? Very, very dangerous diseases like a cholera will erupt. And on top of that, it's an unbearable bad smell, stench everywhere. That's why God instructed us, don't live in the cities in the last days. Go to the mountains. That's why we need to obey God. So second plague is going to affect, and all the sea transportation, all the shipping, and all of that, let us say, now petroleum products, and pumping petrol from the oil wells, from the seabed, everything stops. The whole now commercial activity comes to standstill. Much of the commercial activity of this world is going through shipping. Everything comes to standstill. Then the third plague. Third plague is when the angel poured out his anger on the rivers, reservoirs, canals, ponds, you name. Everything, that means sometimes we call fresh water, all of that turns to blood. Again, same thing happens. All the living creatures, like the fish and the frogs and the tortoise, everything, whatever is there in the rivers and the reservoirs and all of that, ponds, everything dies. Everything dies. But nobody can make use of that dead fish because everybody is down because of the painful sores. Then people don't have anything to drink at this time because all the fresh water, rivers, wells, reservoirs, everything turned to blood. You remember in Egypt? Nile River became blood. People had tough time to have some water to drink. No water. Now, why God is so merciless? We are told all of these seven plagues are poured out without mixture of mercy. No mercy for the merciless people. People who rejected repeatedly. That's why no mercy for them. And the probation is closed. What is that probation? The opportunity for salvation is over. when the door of Noah's ark, when door of Noah's ark was closed by God, nobody could enter. Nobody could enter. Only those who entered before the closing the door, they were safe. They lived. Others perished. Likewise, God is going to close the door for salvation. That time only, after closing the door for salvation, then the plagues are going to be poured out. We are told in Revelation 22 verse 11, when God closes the probation, that means opportunity for salvation. Closing the probation means closing the door for salvation, closing the opportunity for salvation. The righteous will remain righteous and the wicked will remain wicked. That's why the wicked people, they don't have any water to drink, because the third plague made all the water into blood. You remember in Egypt? You can read in Exodus chapter 7 verse 18 onwards, saying, whatever their water they've preserved in their homes, in a bottle or in some vessel, whatever the water they kept for their drinking or for their cooking purpose, that also became blood. That's what is going to happen in the last days. Whatever the water you may preserve in your filter, in your bottles, in your refrigerator, everything will turn to blood. People cannot drink. How can you drink? Somebody may say, oh, my throat is drying almost, I'm at a death point, I'll close my eyes and drink. If somebody says that at that time, not now, then it became like a poisonous blood of the dead person. Blood of the dead person turns to poison. We cannot take the blood from the dead person and give it to someone else or inject to someone else. This is poisonous. Like that, if they drink it, they will have other severe effects of the body in the form of, let us say, some serious sickness. Something like diarrhea, cholera. So that's why they cannot drink. But why God is so merciless on them? Not even providing or not even allowing them a drop of water for them. Because we are told in Revelation chapter 16 verse 6. Revelation chapter 16 verse 6. We are told that these people, the wicked people, they have shed the blood of God's people. They have shed the blood of God's people. Many people of God are going to become martyrs in the last days. Because they go through the time of persecution. This is what we call time of trouble. Time of trouble. And or time of distress, it is translated. So during that time, many are going to lose their lives for their faith in Christ. But blessed are those people who suffer for Christ, who are persecuted, and who may lose their lives. And Jesus said, theirs is the kingdom of heaven, which means they're sure candidates for heaven. This is what we read in Matthew chapter 5, verse 10 and 11. These are the words of Jesus. So that's why they shed the blood of Jesus, God's people, the people of Jesus, or the faithful followers of Jesus. They are going to shed the blood. Already some places, this persecution is already on. But this is going to be worldwide persecution for God's people. That's why God is making them to drink blood. Revelation 16 verse 6. Why God is so merciless? Because they did not show any mercy for God's people. Innocent people. They killed them. Now God is now punishing them. They have to drink this one. If they don't drink, they would die of thirst. This also, the third plague also may not be in many places. Because there are places in this world, no rivers. There are places in this world, there are no fountains. So, that's why these two plagues, surely not applicable to the whole world everywhere. Then the fourth plague is also when the angel poured out his anger with that bowl in his hand, that container in his hand. Then the heat of the sun, now extremely, it became hot and it increased so much. Now in this part of India, especially South India where I come from, and during the summer, especially in the month of May, it goes up to 50 degrees. I know some places in North India, it goes beyond 50. And I heard in some places in Gulf, it goes beyond 50 sometimes. I read in 2005 in Iran. Iran, in the desert of Iran, that desert is called Lut. It came up to 71 degrees. The heat increased up, or heat came up to 71 degrees. Can you imagine if it is now 71 degrees? Just you can leave one, just a plate or some steel plate, or if you have a cemented area on your steps, just you can now drop 2 spoons of oil and break egg, 1 or 2 eggs, then leave it, surely it will turn to omelette. That much heat. I know, I read last year in the newspaper, it was there in the newspaper, and one lady has done it, but that was only between 45 to 50 degrees in South India. It was so hot during the month of May, and she just put 2 spoons of oil and broke 2 eggs and just spread it there, and it became omelette without any stove, without any fire, because it's so hot. Just I'm imagining during the fourth plague, because the heat of the sun is going to increase tremendously. If it goes up to 90 degrees, 95 degrees, what would happen? We are told people would be scorched to death, burned to death because of the heat of the sun. Why God is punishing this way? Through now extreme now heat wave conditions, because many people still in many cultures and many religions, they worship sun. In fact, the first day of our week is named after sun. That's why it's called Sunday. Even in India, in Hindi, the major language, they call the first day of the week as Ravivar, which means Sunday. So the day is named after sun. And many people are worshipping. I know there are many people every day, unless they worship, they don't even eat food. They have to see the sun. So all of those people now going to have terrible time, because they knowingly, not that they did not know about Jesus, not that nobody told them about the commandments, knowingly they chose not to worship, not to accept Jesus as the personal savior. That's why they cannot escape. But when it is so hot, you need more water to drink. But where is the water? Third plague, all the water turned to blood. They don't have any water. So many would die. Many will die at this time because of thirst. Not even a drop to drink. Not even a drop to drink. But what about God's people who obeyed God and went to the mountains or the forests? Surely God would provide them, as he provided to Israelites out of the rock. Nothing is impossible to God. God would provide them water and food. And what about that excess or excessive heat, that extreme heat wave conditions? That will not affect God's people. Why? Because you remember Israelites? During the daytime, God protected them as the pillar of cloud. So it was cool because they were covered with the cloud. During the nighttime, God led them as the pillar of fire. So they'll have light as well as no cold. God is going to do that miracle again. That's why what happened in the Old Testament, we need to read and remember so that we can claim those promises. This is the fourth plague. We are told, if you read in Revelation chapter 16 verses 8 and 9, it says, they blasphemed God, they did not repent. They should have said, oh God, we are so sorry, please forgive us. They're not even repenting. But there's no use of repenting, because the opportunity for salvation is already closed. The door of salvation is already closed. But at least, as a human being, they did not regret what they are doing. They were blaspheming. That means cursing God. They were cursing God, not repenting. Now the fifth plague. We are told, when the angel poured out his anger on this earth, like other angels, symbolically, then the seat of the beast and the kingdom of the beast became dark. And it says, now their teeth gnashed against each other. That means hitting each other, the upper jaw and the lower jaw. When does that happen? when it is in a cold season, when you don't have a proper warm clothing, though you are trying to control your upper jaw and lower jaw, and they are clattering, hitting against each other. That's what is happening. Which means, now, thick darkness and also cold wave. Till yesterday, extreme heat wave, and they were burned to death. But whoever survived, now thick darkness, they can't go anywhere. Sometimes people ask me and say, oh, when it is so hot during the fourth plague, can they put on their air condition and feel a little cool and sit there in their house comfortably? Answer is no. Why not? Because how your air conditioner will work, or how your, air cooler can work, it requires electricity. But during this time, all the people are suffering because of the boils, because of that first plague, which from head to foot, they have the sores, painful one. So nobody can go to work. Nobody can, produce electricity. Nobody can supply electricity from the electricity office. Nobody can do anything. That's why completely powered down at this time. If somebody says, I have a small generator, but generator also needs energy, that diesel or petrol, then all of those petrol station, diesel stations, everything, wherever they sell, they're all closed down because everybody is suffering. They're not able to get up, having a hard time to go to restroom, you see, the toilet. But God's people, they're in the mountains. That's why definitely they cannot have the luxury of a air cooler or air condition in the fourth plague. Similarly, in the fifth plague, they cannot have the luxury of room heaters. I know many people in the West, you have nice room heaters to warm up your house during the winter. Nothing can work, nothing will work, because there will be no power at this time. Power cut, because nobody's working, nobody's supplying. So, but again, fifth plague, it is said, they did not repent even now. They were blaspheming God, cursing God. We need to learn a lesson. My brothers and sisters, when suffering comes now, do we blame God? Do we curse God? Do we blaspheme God? Or do we repent and come back to God? But it is beyond now, limit now, because there is no use now of even repentance, because the opportunity for salvation is closed already. But at least, as human beings, they should have showed their humanity, or they should have showed their feelings by saying, we are very, very sorry, God. It is God's intervention, they realize by now. But they're not repenting. And we should not have that hardening of the heart. Their hearts were hardened. That's why they're not able to do anything. Because probation is closed. That time of grace is closed. No more mercy, no more grace. This is the fifth plague all over the world. All over the world. Then the sixth plague. Now we can read that one in Revelation chapter 16, verse 12 to 14. It's called Armageddon. What is Armageddon? Armageddon is the conflict or the battle between good and evil. Now, between Christ and Satan. It is not we, the people of God, should fight with gun or grenade or bomb. No. Our weapon is prayer. Our weapon is God's word. God's word is sharper than any two-edged sword. We are told in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. So, we need not to be equipped or prepared for battle with the wicked people with some gun or some bomb or some knife. No. Our prayer is our weapon, and God's word is our sharp two-edged sword. So, but who will fight for us? God will fight on our behalf. What happened in the time of Gideon? And God told Gideon, only take 300, that's all. But those Midianites, they were like the now locusts everywhere, like the sand of the sea, more than 200,000. But God made a miracle. He fought on their behalf. They killed each other. Israelites, those 300 men, they went with just mud pot, one small candle. and one small trumpet, that's all. They did not take even a small knife. How can you go to war? How can you go to the battlefield without any weapon? God said, you go. And they obeyed, they went. They need not but just they stood and saw how the wicked people are killing each other. That's what is going to happen to us, the Armageddon. We need not to fight. But we are told, three unclean spirits came out like frogs. One came out of the mouth of a dragon. Who is the dragon? Dragon is Satan. We learned that in chapter 12. Dragon represents Satan. Then the beast. Beast represents the political kingdom. But in the last days, the political kingdom is America. Plus, supported by papacy. Then the false prophet. Who is the false prophet representing? All the Protestants and Protestant churches which are not following the Bible. They say we are Protestants. We are Protestants, but not following the Bible. They teach according to their wish. They teach some doctrines which are not in the Bible, like baptism for small children, sprinkling baptism, praying to Mary, or belief in the purgatory, which are not in the Bible. Which are not in the Bible. Praying to the saints instead of praying to Jesus. So all of them now, the evil spirits, they are the evil spirits, came out. They're doing the miracles. They're doing the miracles because they lost their popularity. Now, it says, Euphrates River dried up. In the olden days, in the time of Daniel, when River Euphrates dried up, Babylon lost. Babylon was defeated. Now, Euphrates, that is a river, is there till today. But river is what? Representing symbolically. The symbol is water represents people. Revelation chapter 17 verse 15. John, the water which you saw are the people and the nations. The support of the nations and the people dried up. Is going to dry up for America and papacy in the last days. That's why in order to again kind of gather some momentum, Satan is trying to send evil spirits to do some miracles. This is Revelation chapter 16 verse 13 and 14. They do the miracles. So this is what we are warned in the last days. I know there are many people running for miracles. There are many churches, they're asking, why miracles are not happening in our church? But here Jesus gave a warning saying, in the last days, false Christ, false prophets will come and do the miracles. And if it is possible, they will deceive the very elect. Yes, with the miracles, many people are being deceived. But I'm not saying there are no true miracles. Yes, there are true miracles. Jesus is the same yesterday, today and forevermore. When we pray in the name of Jesus, surely Jesus can do that one if it is His will. But there are many people in the name of Jesus, because false Christs are using the name of Jesus. They're doing the miracles. That's what they said in Matthew chapter 7 verse 22. Lord, Lord, had we not done miracles in your name, cast out demons in your name? And Jesus will say, I never knew you. Depart from me, you lawless people. That's what Jesus is going to say. Which means they're using the name of Jesus, but not using the power of Jesus. There are only two powers in the world to do miracles. One is the power of Jesus, another one is power of Satan. You remember? In the days of Moses, those Egyptian magicians also, they dropped their stick. That also became snake. So Satan also has some power to do the miracles. That's why don't take miracles as the test of the truth or true church. I know many people are doing miracles today. But with whose power they're doing? That's why we need to be very careful. Yes, miracle is good, maybe for a short time. But miracle cannot take us to heaven. It is the truth in Jesus. Jesus only can take us to heaven. That's why follow Jesus and His truth. Where is His truth found? The Bible. That's why this is the sixth plague, Armageddon. The battle between good and evil, Christ and Satan, is going to put an end to this struggle, which we call great controversy. Now, the last plague, seventh plague. When God pours out, that means the angel, seventh angel pours out His anger on this earth, there was a great earthquake which was not there from the beginning of this world, from the creation of this world. Such a big earthquake, huge earthquake, which will shake the whole world. If the earthquake comes, what happens? All the buildings would fall, bridges would fall. This is what is going to happen. All the buildings. I know today we have more and more towns and cities and now high-rise and skyscrapers, big and tall buildings now. everything will fall like dry leaves from that tree. And all the bridges, how strong the bridge may be, the bridges will fall. Then, whenever there is a big earthquake, and we have seen in the last few years, when there was a big earthquake in Indonesia, followed by tsunami, which means, surely, because of the biggest earthquake in the whole world, which never happened so far, that is the first and last time that such a huge earthquake, big earthquake is going to come. Surely it will be followed by tsunami. Which means all the coastal cities and the towns and the villages will be washed away. I know you remember in 2011, March 11th, when the earthquake came in Japan, the waves went up to 33 feet high. Waves in the sea came and struck the coastal areas and caused so much damage, and so many people died in few moments. Now this is the greatest earthquake, which means the greatest tsunami will follow. Which means, let us say, now the height of the waves doubles. Let us say something like 65, 70, 75 or 100 feet tall waves. What will happen to all the coastal cities and the villages? And what will happen to all the islands? That's why we are told in Revelation chapter 16 verse 20, all the islands disappeared. What are those islands? I know there are many islands. We have in India here, Andaman, or near to us, another nation, Sri Lanka, or much of Philippines and Japan. Just only I'm giving example. These are all, most of them, a group of islands. Wherever there is an island, that will disappear. Why it will disappear? Because of the big tidal waves. This is what we call waves of the tsunami. That's why two now punishments or two sufferings. One, the biggest earthquake, which will destroy all the buildings and the bridges. Then followed by tsunami in the coastal areas. But if they are far from the coastal areas, one more attack is coming in the same seventh plague. And John saw, then hailstones are falling from the sky like rain, hailstones. Each hailstone is 1 talent weight. How much is 1 talent? And if you go to Israel, in Israel, 1 talent is 48 kgs weight. So it varies from place to place, at least between something like 35 to 48 kgs weight, varying from place to place. In Israel, 48 kgs. 1 talent means. So big stones will fall from the sky. If big stone is falling from the sky and comes and hits the earth at a great speed because of the gravity, gravitational pull of the earth, then you can imagine each hailstone will hit the earth like a small atom bomb. That much effect will be there. Then what will happen to all the remaining buildings, whichever building is still standing after that big earthquake, or all the trees completely shattered, and people who are still alive, the wicked people, will be completely smashed. This is going to happen. But God's people, no problem, no suffering. That earthquake or that tsunami or that hailstones cannot cause any problem for them. God will protect them and God will spare them from that area. As soon as this is over, we are told in Great Controversy book, page 640 onwards, the tombs or the graves of the God's people who are buried for so many years now, they will be cracked open during this seventh plague because of that biggest earthquake. Then they can see Jesus and those millions and millions of angels coming into the mid-sky, blowing the trumpet. That is the second coming. So right after the seventh plague, without any gap, there will be resurrection, because Jesus will come and with his angels blow the trumpet from the mid-sky. And those who are alive, the faithful people who obeyed God and there in the forests and the mountains, they'll be changed in the twinkling of an eye. Resurrected people, they will resurrect with immortal body. Will be gathered by the angel from four corners of the earth. Whichever village, whichever town, whichever city you are, God's people, whether you are a living saint or a resurrected saint, all of us will be carried by the angel. Our own guardian angel will come and carry us. We are told about Matthew chapter 24 verse 31. Angels will come and carry us to meet God in the midair. Oh, my brothers and sisters, this is going to happen. That's why God is giving us this message of warning in love, so that we will be prepared spiritually, we'll be ready. That's why if it is your desire to follow Jesus and His word and His commandments, make every necessary spiritual preparation. If you are not yet baptized, don't delay. Make preparation and take baptism in the name of Jesus, so that you can become a member of God's family. If it is your decision, I want to offer a prayer. Loving Father, we want to thank you for Jesus and His sacrifice and His loving kindness in which He revealed to John the Revelator, so that we will be prepared spiritually, so that we will not suffer these plagues, but we'll be ready to meet you in the clouds of heaven. Bless all of our brothers and sisters in India and abroad, wherever they're watching this now program online. And lots of them are sharing with their friends and their families, their local churches. And some of them are sharing with their friends and others online. Bless each one of them, Lord, so that we will be prepared, others also can be prepared. Thank you, Jesus, for this privilege to study your word. And bless us and take care of us, so that until we meet next week for the remaining study of Book of Revelation, help us and guide us. Bless us, Lord. Thank you for this blessing of your word, so that you have given us understanding to grasp these wonderful, important truths of these last days. Thank you, Lord, because we pray in Jesus' loving name. Amen. My brothers and sisters, I know God is blessing you, and God will bless you abundantly because you are sharing some of these important truths with your friends, family members, church members, and your neighbors. And some of you are sharing online. God be with you. God bless you. Continue to do that. Pray for me and for this and this ministry also, and we will pray for you. Until we meet again next week to study chapter 17 and 18, God be with each one of us. Let His peace and blessing be with us. Thank you. God bless you.